Bill Collins is next on Larry King Live. Don't go away.
Coming up, hear how seven-time Grammy winner Phil Collins did it all on his latest release. Wrote, produced, sang, and played all the instruments.
Welcome back to Larry King Live in New York. Phil Collins released his first solo album 12 years ago. In that time, he's established himself as an actor, and he continues as frontman for the musical group Genesis. But once again, Collins is going solo, and he's taking the word seriously. In his latest release, the seven-time Grammy winner played all the instruments, wrote all the songs, produced all the tracks. Both Sides from Atlantic Records came out last month. It's already gone beyond platinum. Joining us here in Gotham as he prepares for a 1994 solo tour is Phil Collins. That tour will include the United States.
Oh, yes.
Of course.
Of course.
And Great Britain. Of course.
Of course. And the rest of Europe. And in fact, maybe the rest of the world.
Why couldn't other people have played on the album and just sing, Phil? Why'd you have to do everything?
I don't know. It seemed like a good idea at the time. I wrote everything, of course, as I normally do. And the material was proving to be very personal. And to be honest, I was, because of the nature of the songs, I was also, apart from that, just having a good time learning how to do other things and always wanting to be sort of someone that puts little tripwires in front of myself. I thought I'd have a go at it.
How many instruments?
Well, the guitar and the bass were actually keyboard, you know, they were played from a keyboard with real sounds. So really, I just play the keyboards and the drums, but the idea is to get the idea, is to make, you know, the end
result.
There's
nobody else on this album, right?
No.
But you.
No, no one else. But if you play the guitar parts on a keyboard, which is the sampled sounds, and a bass sounds, you can actually, if you play them like a guitar or bass guitarist, you can make it sound like a real thing.
Okay. I hope. When you say very personal, what do you mean? All songs are written by the person who writes them.
Yes, I suppose the kind of things you go through when you hit the early 40s, you know. I suppose that's part and parcel of it. I mean, you start looking back at your life and you start looking forward, you know. And some of the looking back involves the goals you got, the goals you didn't get, the goals you should have had.
There's some pain in here then.
I suppose there is, because there's always the things that you sort of you missed. But there's lots of things to look forward to as well, you know. But it's easier to write sadder songs than it is to write happier songs.
Really?
Yeah. I find it so.
Is that
why
more songs are sad?
I think so. It's a human trait, I think, when you're a little bit miserable, you don't put on a happy song to lift you out of it. You tend to put on another one to take you down, rather, you know, that kind of thing.
Some people has made whole careers.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, but you also, don't you do a number in here, not about you or yourself, but about those boys that killed someone in England, don't you?
Oh, yeah, there's three songs, actually, about other things, as it were, other than love and life, and one of them is called Sons of Our Fathers, which was, it stemmed from that incident. And it started because in England, when that happened, I mean, because it's a smaller country, the shock waves are felt a lot farther, you know, and they were starting to run articles about the youth and how young the young offenders were. And it just seemed to me that looking at all this news coverage, we just seemed to have... A lot of the kids today, I think, tend not to get the guidance that they had when I was a kid, you know, from the parents. And I think that's video Game Boys and stuff like that. There's lots of reasons for that. But I think maybe if they're not getting the guidance, then possibly they're going out on the street because they're getting a lot older, younger, but without the guidance and the slight pointing in the right direction.
They're getting older, younger, and not ready for it.
Probably, yeah.
Another one, I think the single is Both Sides of the
That's
Story, right?
Right?
That's the one they've made the single out of the album.
Yeah.
How do you choose, or does the purchaser choose, in a sense, what is a hit song out of an album?
I think it used to be radio used to choose it for you, almost, because they used to listen to an album and they used to play, the bias of one track went that way, and the record company put it out as a single. With this particular record, I mean, I deliberately wanted that song out as a single. Not because of necessarily what it said lyrically, although I'm fully behind what it says lyrically, but just as a piece of music, it was a lot more aggressive than people were, I think, what people were going to expect from me.
What lyrically is it saying?
It seems that we're on the edge, you know? A lot of people are on the edge out there, and I just feel that we should, it would be nice, wouldn't it, if we tried to actually hear the other person's point of view and realize that people have another point of view. Have an alternative opinion to yours, And in the song, I give like four different verses, four different little movies, if you like, about how this should happen.
Walking in someone else's shoes, seeing the other side.
Yeah, I mean, the most potent verse to me is the verse with, which is basically a scene from Grand Canyon, the film, where the affluent white businessman turns off the freeway and gets lost suddenly in a war zone of a place that he didn't even know existed. He'd just seen it on CNN, in fact. And, he'd seen it on the news clips and thought, wow, where am I? And then suddenly, two or three guys, or maybe one guy, come up and start, okay, come on, you're in my part of the world now, come on, let me see what you got. And the guy says, wait a minute. Basically, it just seems that there are a lot of kids in that situation where, because of peer pressure or the situation that we have made for them, that this has become their American Express, their kind of their calling card, and this gets them the respect, this gets people to listen to them. Whereas I think what I'm trying to say is that if we saw why that kid takes up the gun, then maybe we would change the way we have created that environment for them.
Do you tour a lot or not a lot?
A lot. When we tour a lot.
It's Genesis, right?
Well, Genesis, we've done a lot of touring over the 23 years I've been with the band, but I mean, on my own, I'm going out next year, and that will be a sort of 6-7-8 month tour, with some gaps, of course, otherwise you drive yourself crazy.
And how about if a movie role comes in between?
Oh, in between time is not so easy, depending on the length of the gap,
Still, singing is your thing, right?
Yeah.
Singing
and writing, but I desperately want to do more acting, and I intend to do that, but it'll be the year after next. Probably.
We'll take a break, come back, and go to your phone calls. Phil Collins' new solo album is Both Sides from Atlantic Records. It's gone through the roof. Naomi Judd still to come. Tomorrow night, Oliver Stone, also here, the new mayor of New York, Rudy Giuliani. And Mark Klass, the father of the young Polly Klass, who was killed in Northern California, will be with us as well. This is Larry King Live. We'll be back with your calls for Phil Collins after this. Don't go away.
We need to hear both sides of the story. And the lights are all on. The world is watching now. People looking for truth. We must not fail now. Be sure before we close our eyes.
To Larry King Live in New York with Oliver Stone tomorrow night, and on Wednesday, Dick Cheney back in Washington. The guest now is Phil Collins. The album is Both Sides. The caller is from Columbia, Missouri. Hello.
Hi. Phil, I've been a big fan of yours for a long time.
Thanks.
And I really like this new album. I want to know how you feel about some of the lack of artistic respect you've gotten in the past from some of your critics who've labeled your music as sort of run-of-the-mill, over-commercialized pop, and is this new album sort of a reaction against that image of your music?
Well, I'm always trying to rattle my cage a little bit. The critical abuse kind of used to bother me more than it does now, actually. I mean, I could get reassessed, but I think probably it's too late for that. So I think I'm doomed to a life of just sort of people buying the records, but the critics hating me, which is...
You're doomed to a life of commercial success.
Yeah, I guess that's...
Why do the critics hate you?
Well, I don't know. I think it tends to be because they tend to sort of assume that if you have a lot of success, which I've fortunately had, that you've got the lowest common denominator, and you're changing your musical output to sort
In
of
your own heart, have you ever copped out for... commerciality?
No, absolutely not. I mean, it's not even in my dictionary, but I just think I'm not hip enough, that's all, who cares?
Houston, Texas, hello.
Yes, this is Mike in Houston, and I think your music's excellent. You don't have anything to apologize for. I saw you on our scene the other night, though, and I'm just curious if you think your comments about building bridges with your music fell upon deaf ears. That was the impression I got.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, Arsenio, he gave me a great platform, especially being a black chat show host. I mean, I felt that we did actually discuss the things that I really wanted to talk about, and I felt were important enough to talk about. But I felt he was a little non-committal. He could have actually said yes, I agree, or no, I don't.
What were you saying that he?
Well, no, you see, I did previous night. I'd hosted the Billboard Awards, and in that program, Dr. Dre and Snoop Doggy Dogg, who been very vast amount of records sold this year, and also the sort of the slightly dark mood wise, I hasten to add, sort of came across the evening and dark atmosphere. And I happened to mention it because I was the host and I can say what I want, you know. And I said that, well, that was just starting to get dark in here, and everybody being very sensitive nowadays, and it shows what how many people are on the edge, came out and said, well, it's a very racist comment. And I mean, I just didn't mean it like that. You know, I just meant that the atmosphere suddenly went, oh, God, this is heavy.
So you explained that to Arsenio.
So I explained it.
And he bought it?
Well, I think he bought it. I just don't think he could be seen to be buying it.
Pittsburgh, hello.
Hi, Phil. I am also a longtime fan, and I did catch the Billboard Awards and Arsenio. And there's a lot of music out there that is very violent, very that can be seen as racist. Do you feel that this is going to be continue to be a trend, or are we going to move away from this?
Well, I got to say that, I mean, something I didn't say on the Arsenio Hall show was actually that I think there's a lot of good rap, you know. I mean, he said to me, you don't like rap, do you? And I kind of said, no, I don't, because most of it doesn't speak to me. But there's an awful lot of rap and dance music out there that I kind of, well, especially the dance stuff, anyway, that I do like, because it's groove-orientated and I'm a drummer. But I find there's more than the fair share of really negative militant rap. And I think that is having a negative effect on young kids because they believe it. And even one of the rappers the next night, you know, he was being very articulate and then turned around and said, yeah, but the police, man, the police don't know what they're talking about. You know, I've got no respect for them. And kids all over the country are listening to this, you know, and I just think that there's a bit too much of that. I think it's going to go to the edge and it's going to come back. It's inevitable. Things like that do, you know.
Richmond, Virginia, last call for Phil Collins, and then Naomi Judd. Hello.
Hi, Phil. This is Pat.
Hi.
I've heard that Daryl and Chester won't be touring with you next year, and I was wondering just what musicians are going to be in your band.
Well, Daryl will be touring. I mean, I had to make some changes just because I like to keep things a little bit fresh, a little bit different around me. So I have a different rhythm section. Nathan East is playing bass, and Ricky Lawson's going to be playing drums. I've got Steve Foreman playing percussion. I've got the new horn section.
When does the tour start?
Vine Street Horns, and that's April 1st in Europe. Daryl's going to be with us, though, and so is Brad Cole, and I have Arnold McCullough and Amy Keys. It's about a 12-piece band, but it's some fresh faces, new faces, which is always good.
Continued good luck, Phil.
Very nice.
Finally,
to
good
see
meeting you.
Yes.
Every time he's been with us, it's been Satellite. Phil Collins, Both Sides is the album. It's gone beyond platinum. Naomi Judd is familiar with that territory of record sales as well. She's next. Don't go away.